Good evening to each one of you on this really warm day also. We welcome Mr. Pratap Bhanu Mehta for having spared his time, for having made the effort. Some of the comments that came from some of the members who are obviously very avid readers and followers of Mr. Mehta's work in newspaper is the corridor gossip was that if he speaks as well as he writes, it's going to be quite a thing. So we have lots of expectations. We are all here. Unfortunately, the court finishes a little late, so we are hoping that more members will join in. We welcome Honorable Justice Chilameshwar and Honorable Justice Kurian Joseph. They spared their time to be with us. We also welcome Mr. Fali Nariman, Mr. Ashok Desai, Mr. Ganguly, all the senior advocates who are here. May I request our Vice President, Sir Shekhar Sir, to please present a bouquet of flowers. We are already a little late, so may I straight away request President Sir to please welcome Mr. Pratap Bhanu Mehta and also introduce him.
Good evening, everybody, lordships, distinguished senior advocates here, and friends. It gives me a great privilege and pleasure to invite Sri Pratap Bhanu Mehta this evening on behalf of the Supreme Court Bar Association. Mr. Mehta is quite well known and he really doesn't need much of an introduction, but he's one of those few Indians of whom every one of us should be really proud of. He's one of the finest thinkers today in the country on constitutional issues, legal issues, sometimes philosophical issues as well. And I have heard him a couple of times. I never miss his articles in the newspapers, magazines, and others, as also his books. It really gives us an extremely refreshing approach to most of the issues that we are confronted with as lawyers and judges on a daily basis. He looks at it from completely, you know, new perspective, all these issues, whether it's constitution or law, or public life, or accountability in society, or even violations of human rights. Every aspect of which affects us on a daily basis, Pratap Bhai looks at it very, very differently, but most of all, fiercely objectively, and never, never ever would you find that he is influenced by anything except his inner conscience. And that makes Pratap Bhai one of the foremost today thinkers in the country. As you may be aware that he is one of the most highly qualified intellectuals in the country today, having graduated from Oxford, having done his LLM from Princeton, having taught in various universities in the world, including the NYU Law School. He has been a visiting professor at the Harvard on various aspects. And he is truly extremely distinguished in his personal life. So we at the SCBA and the Executive Committee have been really working hard, trying to create some kind of an environment where we can have intellectual debate for our members. I must say that I am slightly disappointed that this evening I have not been able to attract too many people in this hall. Perhaps the fault lies on me because I was the one who thought that we should have a bigger capacity, so we are here.
Otherwise, my library perhaps would have pulled more number of people. But anyway, I am not daunted by it, because even if I have to hear him alone, it's still a privilege and a pleasure. So I'm here. But the fact that all of you are here this evening, those of you who are here, the honorable judges, the honorable senior lawyers here, who are our mentors, who are our guides, who are our friends as well. So it's really heartening that at least all of you have taken time off to come here and listen to Pratap Bhai. This will encourage us in the SCBA and the Executive Committee immensely, because we really want to try and help, if we can, in whatever way, some kind of intellectual debates in the Bar Association, some kind of intellectual development for the young members of the Bar. And we are starting next week, next month, we are even having continuing education program which is being set up by Professor Madhav Menon for us. It's a 3-day very serious program for our youngsters, and I have no doubt that many of the distinguished seniors who are of the Bar would perhaps accept our invitations to be with these young lawyers and give them their experiences, their knowledge. And I'm happy to say that at least on the first request, none other than Mr. Pali Nariman has been kind enough to accept that invitation. So it really gives us a great sense of satisfaction, a great sense of encouragement that our efforts are fructifying. We will continue. Our life is still December. So we will continue till December in whatever way, best way that we think will help the Bar. So having said that, I must say that it's really a great privilege to have you, Pratap Bhai, here. We are greatly enthused that you accepted the invitation at the first request, and you have come here this evening. We feel privileged, and we thank you very sincerely on behalf of my executive committee and on behalf of the Bar and on myself personally that you are here. We look forward to hearing you this week, this evening, and thank you so much.
The reason that President Sir was giving. Actually, we have now started an SCBA YouTube channel. So all the programs that we have are video recorded and put on our YouTube channel in addition to the website. So I think because we are getting more number of viewers there, members are getting to see what they see in the comfort of their homes. So not many of them feel encouraged. But may I now request Mr. Pratap Bhanu Mehta to please give his talk on the crisis of the professions.
Shanji, Shekharji, and Aishwaryaji, it's truly humbling and intimidating being here. There's so many people in this audience who we've looked up to for years and years. And I must confess, I was in two minds about accepting this invitation. Partly just a room full of lawyers is always intimidating. First, I thought I might speak on a subject related to law. I firmly believe that law is too important to be left to lawyers. But then I thought, well, it is too important to be left to lawyers, except when you're in the presence of lawyers. But what I thought I could perhaps usefully do on this occasion is raise a large political, social question about the nature and status of professional life in India. And I'll just spend a couple of minutes talking about how I came to pose this question in the way I'm going to do over the next 25 minutes or so. And I hope that it might actually help situate some of the debates that are taking place around legal reform, some of the very contentious debates that are taking place in the SBCA around the legal profession, in a much broader sociological and political context. Because my sense is that there is actually a parallel debate happening across almost all the professions in India right now, and perhaps not just in India, more globally as well. And we sometimes, I think, perhaps analytically misdiagnose what the challenges facing particular professions are when we confine the debates too much, in a sense, to the internal dynamics and the power struggles and the associational life of a particular profession. So what I'm going to offer is a tour of perplexity is not a guide for the perplexed, as it were. But it might help us situate what all of us do, and I'll talk about what I mean by professions in a second, not just the legal profession, but I think of academia as a profession as well, certainly the medical profession, in a larger historical and social context, and try and make the case that that's worth keeping in mind when we think about what the challenges facing our professions are. I myself came to, as it were, an interest in this question, and this is a very preliminary expression of that interest, after having worked for some years on India's public institutions, the nature of the Indian state, Indian politics, Indian political economy. And certainly if you look at public discourse and public argument in India, you could argue that a lot of it is focused on public accountability and the nature of our state institutions. And that's absolutely understandable. After all, politics is architectonic to everything that happens in most societies, particularly in a democracy. And the roots of a lot of challenges we face, everything from corruption and accountability sense to the delivery of social services, we all want to trace it back to some, as it were, malfunctionings in our politics, in our democracy. But the more you look at the nature and character of our society, and you know the nature and character of accountability institutions, which is what I had started looking at, the more it becomes clear that, particularly if you place India in a kind of comparative frame of modernization, advanced democracies of Western Europe, North America, but also other contemporary developing societies, that we cannot get a handle on this accountability question until we get a handle also on the nature and character of professional life in our society. And there is a dynamics to this professional life that runs parallel to that of the life of politics and the life of state, although obviously they intersect in many ways. But what I'm beginning to sense is that the sense of crisis and the crisis of legitimacy in the professions is actually, in some ways, I'll say this as a provocative remark, even deeper than the crisis of the state. We all talk about state failures, we all talk about market failures as technical economists, but what is it about professional failures and social failures that has escaped our analytical attention? And there's actually very little analytical work on it. I mean, there's some work in the context of the legal profession, there's some work on medical ethics, but there's very little work of the kind that you find, for example, on the Indian state and public institutions, trying to situate this context, as I said, in a context outside of simply squabbles between judges and lawyers and SBCA and the kinds of reports you get in the newspapers. Right? Now, just to motivate the question, and maybe some of you will disagree with it, but what strikes you across contemporary India, about contemporary India, is that if you look across all the major professions, and I'll describe what I mean by the profession in a minute, but what we conventionally think of as technically oriented, knowledge-based, middle-class professions, whether it's medicine, whether it's law, whether it's academia, you can think of any range of professions, there seems to be a deep and profound sense of crisis. And there is an existential crisis. Recently, a doctor, Dr. Radhakrishnan, wrote this extraordinarily moving and disturbing blog about why he would not recommend that his son go into the medical profession. Right? And there are lots of arguments he makes that are very contingent, but two that really jump out, right, was one, him writing to his son saying, to enter professional life in India now is to put your integrity on the line every day. That you cannot think of a form of professional existence where you do not feel that somehow your integrity is not compromised. You in some sense feel defiled just by being part of a profession, even though you may not yourself have done anything wrong. I mean, it's an absolutely extraordinary statement to make. But if you think about it, I suspect there's a lot of people in this room who, you know, who actually feel the same way about professions, right? So there's almost a sense of existential crisis about our kind of ethical relationship to these professions. He had a second and much more kind of you might say, mundane or self-serving argument in this blog, which was that the work-life balance that the professions impose upon human beings, right, are no longer the kinds that befit a humane and civilized society. And you might say, well, this is a kind of self-serving argument. After all kinds of people have to work hard and work too much, and the work-life balance is an issue in almost every walk of life, particularly amongst the dispossessed. Why should it particularly matter for professionals, right? But I think he was actually trying to get a larger point about the nature of these professions, which I'll kind of come to in a minute. But I think you'll all agree that there is a sense of existential angst. One of the privileges of being at CPR is that we actually get a lot of young lawyers in particular, and law school graduates pass through our institution, some extraordinary ones, some of whom are in this audience as well. And I have been struck how many of them seem to go through a kind of existential crisis about their relationship to the legal profession in some way or the other. So there is a sense of existential crisis. There is a sense of institutional crisis. Every single profession in India is facing an extraordinarily politicized battle about what the appropriate form of regulation for that profession should be. The Medical Council of India, the Bar Council of India, everything ranging from issues of conflicts of interest to legal ethics, the situation of that profession in the broader structures of state and market, you almost get the sense that there's no institutional clarity at all on what these norms are. So there is a profound sense of institutional conflict. And I would submit, increasingly, there is a crisis of legitimacy as well. George Bernard Shaw once joked that all professions are, by their very nature, conspiracies against the laity. So there is a sense that always professions are kind of geared against the masses, geared against those they are meant to serve. But if you look across the range of services, and again, Dr. Radhakrishnan pointed this out in this blog, you know, just some data that's emerging on how many doctors are actually assaulted in the course of their medical practice these days. Now, some of it you can place or, you know, sort of attribute to the fact that doctors can't always produce good outcomes. Patients get frustrated, start beating up doctors, right? This is a, right? But I think there is a larger point that even though the individual services of particular professionals are highly valued, you'll always appreciate a particular doctor or a particular lawyer, the very same kinds of things that we are beginning to attribute to politicians as a class, right? Sab chor hain, something's wrong. That very same discourse is kind of creeping in the public perception of professions as a whole. And again, I mean, you know, I try and study politics and in a sense of what people's perception of politics is. I'm just constantly struck by how deep this legitimacy of the crisis of professions is also beginning to be, right? Yeah. So I think it is worth thinking about why it is that there is this sense of crisis. Why does this crisis even matter? And perhaps very briefly, I'll touch upon it, you know, what are the possible ways out. But I think in order to think about the possible ways out, which I won't go into today because I actually do think as a methodological prescription, there are too many people sort of suggesting cures, not enough people trying to understand what the dynamics are. But hopefully we can orient that conversation in that direction in discussion. Now, why does this crisis in the profession matter, right? You might say it matters because of for the well-being of those in the profession. It matters because of those the profession is meant to serve. Obviously, if your medical profession is broken to the extent that it is, apparently, it will have huge ramifications for the nature of patient care, for health outcomes. If your legal profession is broken to the extent that people seem to think it has, it will have huge ramifications for our ideas of justice, of our sense of the legitimacy of the system of delivery of justice. So there are all these instrumental reasons in some ways for which why this crisis in the profession matters. But I think it is worth taking a step back from these very immediate concerns and think about placing the professions in the larger context of India's transition to modernity. Now, when the debate on the professions arose in the 19th century Europe, and I think that debate is very relevant to us, one of the things people clearly grasped about the professions was that the professions are a form of organizing society that are very central to the idea of modernity itself, and express that idea in a way in which almost no other form of labor or profession actually does. So what is at stake in getting the professions right is not just particular services, right, but a fundamental conception of what, in a sense, a just and creative society should look like, right? How did that argument go? The modern conception of a profession, I mean, obviously it has theological roots. The very idea of, you know, to profess in its classical sense was to profess the truths, which was then associated with the clergy. It's interesting that you can't find a word in the Indic language that actually retains that connotation. Vyavsay doesn't quite capture it, right? It makes it instrumental to begin with, right? But in the modern conception of a profession, the idea of a profession was located at the intersection of three very important claims in modernity. The first very important claim was obviously the idea of knowledge specialization, right? That there are forms of knowledge specialization that are very central to the division of labor in modernity. You will need, you know, you can't have people being the clergy and the lawyer and the canon lawyers all rolled in ones, right? There are specialized forms of knowledge, right, which will have to be made available to the public for their service. And these forms of knowledge, by their very nature, produce a form of asymmetry between the knowledge provider and those who receive it, right? But fundamentally, the idea of professions was associated with a deepening division of labor and a greater specialization of knowledge, right? So even science becomes, as it were, a profession or a vocation. This is a very familiar, straightforward idea, right? The second very important idea it was associated with, which we don't pay enough attention to, was that the profession was going to be the principal site of individual social mobility in an inegalitarian society, right? And the reasoning behind this was the following. I mean, I'm over-schematizing the sociology a little bit, but hopefully you'll see its relevance to the Indian context in a little. That access to capital and access to land, right, the aristocracy and capital, are by and large likely to be aligned with births much more, right? So those who have access to land retain access to land. The flows of capital are very much, no matter what we say in terms of creative ideas, are very much aligned to hereditary privilege in some ways, right? The laboring and the working classes, right, remain stuck in particular positions. They are, in a sense, if you like, victims of a poverty trap, right? Often reproducing the very deprivations generation after generation.
Can you switch off the mobile speeds? Every one of you, I beg you to do so.
Sorry.
The only, as it were, route out, right? The only avenue that provides a form of social mobility were going to be the professions, because, again, this is sort of sociology 101, your ticket to entry in those professions was going to be your educational qualification. And if you created a structure whereby your educational qualifications and the forms of regulation that that profession enshrined did not reproduce hereditary privileges or inherited privileges, this would, in a sense, be the most open space available in society, right? And it's an important thing to think about when you think of the social legitimacy of professions in India, a point I'll come to in a second. The third feature of modernity, right? So division of labor, social mobility, and the third feature was a new form of morality in the context of an emerging capitalism. Right? Now, when we think about capitalism, capitalism was thought to be by everybody both a liberating and a corrosive force at the same time. right? I mean, even if you think of Karl Marx, right? He thought of capitalism as a dynamic force that would liberate people from the inherited shackles of feudalism, right? But if you were not a Marxist, there was a basic idea that a modern society would require three different spheres of existence if, as it were, different modes of being were to balance out. There's going to be capital, where the operating principle, no matter what we say, is going to be profit. Capitalism's creativity comes from profit, right? You try and take away the profit motive, you don't have that form of creativity that's associated with profit. Counterbalancing that is the principle behind the state, which ideally would be based on the coercive power of the state, backed by democratic legitimacy, right? But its essential logic, its essential legitimacy, and it's, again, the principle that runs through his action, is the principle of democratic legitimacy. The third sphere, in a sense, which would make this up, would be what we now call civil society. But civil society composed of two different components. One is what we think of as in the NGO world now, a civil society where the modus operandi is voluntary persuasion, right? It's neither backed by a profit motive, nor is it backed by democratic legitimacy in the coercive power of the state. It is simply backed by voluntary exchange, right? But the second and cardinal feature of the civil society would be a form of associational life where principles of knowledge could be allowed their own autonomous reign, independently of a profit motive or the imperatives of a state bureaucracy, right? So when we talk about self-regulation and autonomy, right, behind that is a very deep and profound sociological idea, right, that there's got to be this space in society where, if you like, the dominating principle of action is in a sense going to be the meaning of that knowledge or the meaning of that profession, unencumbered by these two powerful forces, state power and, as it were, capital, right? And the professions were, in a sense, the one form of organization that, in a sense, fulfilled all of these kind of three requirements. Expressed knowledge specialization, carving out an autonomous sphere of existence that shielded society from both state and capital, right? And that was the art of self-regulation and autonomy, right? And also the site of great social mobility, right? They also had this cardinal virtue, which, you know, theorists like Durkheim and Weber sort of talked about, which is, of all the modern professions, the only ones likely to give their adherents a new sense of morality and personal identity, right? So the assumption was that those who labor, right, the traditional proletariat, working class, working classes, peasants, those classes are still under the realm of necessity, right? It's very hard to argue that what they are doing is by way of choice, right? I mean, not even the most hard-hearted capitalists would actually argue that, right? There was something about the idea of a profession where you could say, you know, I choose my profession, that it actually has the ability of creating a new form of self that's not bound by hereditary privilege, that's not bound by the realm of necessity, but where a sense of vocation becomes your personal identity as well, right? And the idea was that if you have the expansion of the professions, you actually achieve a lot of these things simultaneously. As I said, social mobility, knowledge specialization, a new form of morality, and a very healthy antidote to these two powering forces of power, state and capital, that could encase you, right? Which is why almost every single modern, you know, theorist of modernity to be taken seriously, whether it's Max Weber, whether it's Durkheim, but not just there. I mean, if you look at Radhakamal Mukherjee, the great Lucknow School of Sociologists, right? They were absolutely convinced that if you don't get professions right, you actually cannot get a healthy modernity right. Because we can't think of any other vocation that can perform these kinds of functions in the way the professions do. So the stake in, as it were, getting the professions right were tremendously high. It went beyond simply, in a sense, service delivery. As R.H. Tawney put it, he said, what's distinguished about professionals is professionals may, as in the case of a successful doctor or a lawyer, grow rich, but the meaning of their profession, both for themselves and the public, right, is not that they make money, but that they make health, but that they make law, or they provide good government. Right? So it is a very distinctive and special form of morality, I would argue, and a special form of social organization. Right? Now, the reason I've gone into this large kind of macro-sociological background is because if you look at the contemporary crisis of the professions in India, in a kind of much deeper form, but you could argue in Western Europe and North America as well, right? It comes in part from actually not understanding fully what the stakes in getting this professional life right are. What do I mean by that? So, first and foremost, right, and this will be the segue into thinking about, you know, what are the particular elements. I've identified 9 or 10 elements of the crisis, but I'll just go through very quickly, so I assure you it won't take too long, that seem to cut across all professions, right? So the first element that seems to cut across all professions comes from this large sociological claim I made about, in a sense, the knowledge-based identity of their profession. When you had professions controlled by small guilds, when you had professions controlled by, small elites, they were located in organizational forms where they could present themselves as antidotes to state and capital, right? Whatever else we might do as lawyers, of course we serve capitalism. The whole point is we are finding a niche within a larger capitalist system, right? That's the market. That's where the clients come from. But the meaning of our practice and the norms that govern it are not, in a sense, governed by the profit motive, right? Now, one of the biggest confusions happening in contemporary India is, in a sense, these organizational forms, new organizational forms, are emerging in all professions that are making these neat separations very hard to sustain. They were always hard to sustain, but perhaps even harder to sustain. The most obvious example is the medical profession, right? What happens to the idea of a medical profession when doctors are, in a sense, shareholders in profit-making hospitals, right? Again, two very different principles, right? The creativity of profit, right? Running in tension with the autonomy of the domain of knowledge, right? This is just to give sort of one, in a sense, kind of example. Same thing applies to universities. What happens to the idea of academia and academics, right? If you are situated in the context of profit-making universities, right? I'm not being naive about the need to generate wealth. I mean, that's a different kind of concept, argument. But the idea that the organizational forms that are available to you, right, no longer grant you the autonomy of, as it were, a knowledge-producing unit that is self-regulating, that idea is becoming harder and harder to sustain across every single profession, right? Perhaps it's an even deeper crisis. I mean, you know, as I said, there's these three different ways in which, you know, three motives that impel us in society: profit in markets, democratic coercive legitimacy in the state, and voluntary persuasion in civil society. And one of the things I don't like about this contemporary way of thinking about institutional architectures, you know, when we talk of public-private partnerships, for example, when we talk of, you know, even, let's say, a debate over an organization like BCCI, fundamentally, what's happening is you're confusing principles that should be applicable to one domain and importing them to another, right? If an organization has a monopoly, then it has to have democratic legitimacy. If it has voluntary persuasion and is a civil society organization, then it cannot seek the coercive power of the state behind it, right? So this kind of architectural confusion is inflecting a lot of other organizational forms, but I think is going to affect and deepen the crisis of the professions particularly deeply. The second, as it were, I think challenge to the professions, again, placing them in a broad architecture rather than talking about the specifics, is this very tricky question of are professionals, professions, the enablers of social mobility or not, right? I think this is a question that any legitimate profession cannot escape, right? Do professions within themselves, in the way they are governed, in the way power is allocated within professions, right? I know the SBCA is having lots of debates about appointments of senior counsel, gender representation, all of these things, right? And one can argue about them from within the perspective of a profession. But there is absolutely no question that a profession that does not exhibit social inclusion, right, is in the long run not going to be a socially legitimate profession. And I must confess, all the data is showing that the legal profession actually probably has the farthest to travel in this area, both on the dimension of gender, where I think the education story is going to correct it in 5 to 10 years, but particularly on the dimension of caste. I'm not talking about, you know, head-based reservation systems, but there is a reason why, you know, when we make demands for social, for self-regulation in India, right? The reason those demands fall on deaf ears is because there is an inherent suspicion that if you leave these autonomous domains of professions to their own devices, they will not be the vehicles of greater social mobility, right? For all our anger at politicians, and this I can say with full confidence, right? I mean, we have survey work, everything shows, at the end of the day, people still trust politicians in the state because they think the one thing that those two professions have in common, whether it's through reservation, whether it's through the logic of democratic politics, is there are inbuilt pressures towards social inclusion, right? None of our professions have those inbuilt measures towards social inclusion, and which is why this debate over, you know, I mean, this question gets asked rhetorically, how many Dalits are there in the media? Right? How many Dalits are there in higher echelons of the law? Right? Now, again, we don't want to, you know, reduce the argument to quotas, but there is a deep challenge that these professions are facing. And in a very practical way, it's going to affect these professions because the demand for greater state regulation is going to gain political legitimacy because of these deep reservoirs of suspicion that these professions reproduce inheritance rather than break it. The third sort of peculiar challenge, and this challenge is a bit kind of paradoxical for these professions, comes from a very different direction. This is the what you might call the perverse effect of meritocracy applied to professional life. Okay? And this, I've been looking at it in comparative context a lot, and you know, in thinking about the pros and cons of meritocracy. But in the Indian context in particular, the idea of a formally meritocratic profession, right, has had some unintended and perverse consequences, which I just want to lay out in a couple of minutes. Right? So at one level, the good news is our professions are formally meritocratic professions, right? You have the education qualifications, you take exams. Now it's another matter whether those exams themselves are meritocratic or not. Lots of studies show that actually more exams-based systems actually, rather than helping social mobility, because the rich can invest more in support systems, actually end up reproducing it. There's a whole debate to be held about meritocratic exams, right? But in a society which is a low-trust society, and which does not trust the professions to self-regulate and provide avenues of social mobility, there is a pressure on finding criteria of entry into the profession that are, quote, objective and commensurable. And by objective, one means a way of, as it were, testing people that does not involve any human judgment or peer review, right? So one of the things we like exams so much is, you know, exams are objective. Interview mein pata nahi kya hoga, subjectivity, right? And remember, because this is distrust of communities of peers judging others, right? You know, it's a debate relevant to lots of arguments that are going on in the court right now. Right? So there is going to be societal pressure across the board on finding ways of recruiting people into the profession that are objective and commensurable, right? Which don't rely on one selection committee here, another selection committee there, right? Now, there are only two known instruments that are objective and commensurable. One instrument is an exam, right? Assuming that you can get the marking fair and so forth. But an exam is a very different way of judging people than traditionally the way professions have judged people. Exams have been an aspect of entry, right? But by and large, judgments of gradation within professions have often relied on peer judgment. Very central to all professional lives, right? In academia, you have peer review, blind peer review, right? In designating counsel or judges, presumably there's a culture of taking peers into account, right? University selections were done by groups of experts who were your peers. One of the things you might have noticed is across all of these professions, there is greater pressure to find, quote unquote, objective and commensurable criteria. In academia, we are beginning to throw out interviews. The UGC has come up with this points scale, right, which eventually will remove discretion from selection committees. It is completely counterproductive because that point scale, you know, which is based on number of publications and so forth, ultimately a profession involves judgment of some kind, right? You can't do it on a purely numerical basis. But the pressures for creating those kinds of selection processes are actually growing in a sense, all professions. So that's one objective measure. But the other objective measure in a profession actually turns out to be the good old one of money. During the 2009 financial crisis, I was actually struck by the fact that not only was the financial crisis in the US a failure of state regulation, but it was very clear it was also a failure of all independent regulatory bodies, accountants who were not reporting conflicts of interest, right? Investment banks, right? Right? Law firms, right? I mean, it was absolutely extraordinary failure of even, right? And one of the things that Raghuram Rajan pointed out at that point was that part of the reason for that failure was there was an inherent conflict of interest within, as it were, those professions. So if you are judging a banker by how much money he pushes out the door, obviously he has an incentive to loan even to high-risk customers, right? If you are judging lawyers by how much revenue they bring in, right, at one level, right, it is going to skew the incentives in terms of how they actually package things. There's a wonderful Harvard Business School study, by the way, on, you know, mergers and acquisitions and the role of consultancy firms in mergers and acquisitions, right? And it basically found, so it kind of tried to study, okay, 5 years after a merger and acquisition took place, was that merger and acquisition a good thing or a bad thing, right? How did it turn out? And what it found was that the structure of payment entirely determined the outcome. So where the payments were contingent upon a merger and acquisition going through, independent consultants actually recommended mergers and acquisitions. And by and large, all of them did much badly, right? Then ones where the structure of payment, I mean, this is 101 incentive compatibility, right? But the basic point was that the pressure to generate revenues was skewing the professional practice. Now, this is the easy part. The hard part is, where was this pressure to generate revenues coming from? The moralist in us says greed. People have become greedy, right? It's a very easy answer. You know, people don't want to live within their means. The more uncomfortable answer is that it was actually coming from that same meritocratic impulse that we all value in modern society. What was that meritocratic impulse? In the United States, and the parallel process is happening in India at a much different level, you know, at one level you can say, look, this is a very open time. At least the formal discriminations of caste and gender no longer exist in education institutions. You know, in the, even in the 1960s, you know, Jews had a different, required a different entry score in Harvard, or so did Catholics, or Dalits were excluded from education. So formally the education system has in a sense become much more open, right? And so in that sense, there has been a profound revolution in our idea of meritocracy because these ascriptive characteristics are supposed to matter less. But when your structures of peer review, when your structures of inculcation into a profession, right, when the structures of what prospects you might have as a junior lawyer, when will you be nominated senior counsel, depend on structures of peer review where the chances of reproducing old networks are very, very high, right? What do you do? So what began to happen in big law firms or big accountancy firms is, again, I'm stylizing, in the old days, a bunch of smart people would say, yeah, we broadly know he's a good lawyer, right? Promote them or whatever. There's some structure, you might say, if you're cynical, you might say an old boys network. If you want to use more polite language, you might say a structure of peer review, which determine these things. But those structures began to lose legitimacy, and so you want objective criteria. What could be a more objective criteria than raising revenue? We often talk about conflict of interest in doctors, right? And certainly in certain kinds of ownership issues, there are real conflicts of interest, right? We often say, you know, doctors are actually generating more, you know, prescribing more tests because hospitals want to generate more revenue. That's the easy case. Harder cases, suppose one doctor goes to an hospital and says, I think I'm a better doctor than the guy you're hiring. And I ask you the question, how do I know that? One option is I could have a structure, as I said, of knowledge-based peer review, right? Do 50 other doctors say you are a better doctor than this? Or the other I say is, look, let the market decide, right? Incredibly more objective, right? And the reason I'm putting this hypothesis forward is because my own sense is that I don't think the moralism about greed and profit motive is going to be the easy solution. Or it's rather the easier diagnosis for where this very deep impulse, right, for this kind of objective yardstick in all professions is coming from. And unfortunately, in the professions, it'll end up being revenue, right? Partly because it's in the inherent nature of that profession. There's a great asymmetry. I mean, I don't know if you took a poll in Delhi and said, who are the top 15 lawyers in Delhi?